Okay, so I guess it's Helene. Yeah.
Thanks a lot. It's a great privilege to be here. I always enjoyed and learned a lot from Carmen and from Ricardo, and this time is no different. You'll be happy to hear. So I'm going to start by taking a few points out of a very rich set of materials that they have been producing, and emphasizing some of those which I think are very relevant in order to discuss more of the theories down the road. So the theorization of international financial crisis and also of international financial cycles. So we have seen a very impressive historical description of international financial crisis by Carmen. And she has emphasized, I think, some very important things, which are that usually at the onset of international financial crisis, we see some types of domestic or external liberalization, and this can play out in the form of deregulation of various kind, financial flows, or some monetary policy. And I just want to emphasize that it's both about what one can do in terms of lending and how credit can expand, but it's also possibly also about funding costs. So it's both sides which can be affected by this type of shocks. Another thing that I think Carmen shows in her work that it is possible to predict to some extent financial crisis, but it's a hard game. And there are some specific sequencing that tend to show up sometime in the data, and some triple crises that tend to be extraordinarily damaging, and that her work, the Kamensky-Reinhardt paper has been the first to show how damaging this could be. But the sequencing is not always the same, and financial crises tend still to be hard to predict. We do a lot of type 1 and type 2 errors. So we do tend to sometimes be able to predict crises, but we over-predict some crises. And this has been, I think there has been some very important papers written by Carmen also in that area, but maybe it is time to do some more work now that we have a lot more data and revisit those matters. Now, another very striking thing, I think, in the data, and it could be also seen in the data that that Ken shown, is that there tends to be waves of crisis. So there tends to be bunching over time of crisis. So in some cases, there's maybe a role for capital flow bonanzas. There's the influence of different push and pull factors, as the work of Guillermo and Carmen has very carefully shown, which is very important. And in the push factors, that can link to some synchronization of the crisis events, which is maybe very especially important these days. We also have learned from Guillermo and Carmen about the fear of floating and how important then that can be for the transmission of shocks internationally, international spillovers. I'm not going to go into a discussion of dilemma versus trilemma, but this is also related in terms of how these spillovers may operate and how crises may be spread. Okay. So now I would like to shift a little bit the topic from crisis to cycles, because I think one thing that is very striking that has come from the evidence presented by Carmen, by Ken, and by Alan, is that very often crises are booms gone bust. And so to understand those crises, therefore, I think we have to try to understand the entire cycle. Now, we tend to have more and more empirical evidence, and Atif and Amir have also worked on that, that there is this very important risk build-up phase, okay, before the crisis, where credit to GDP goes up, we have other variables moving, the real exchange rate, as Carmen showed, leverage of intermediaries tend to be higher. And during that build-up phase, we have this this behavior of risk premium and spreads, which has been described by several papers now, in particular Krishnamurti and Mir. And these risk premium and spreads tend to be low during the risk build-up phase. So this is what prompt us to think that we're in a risk build-up with quantity moving, we see some leverage going up, but it doesn't show up in the risk premium and the spreads. And then when the crisis happens, that's what Atif was describing. Suddenly we see some big jumps. Now, it is also true that which booms turn into bust is hard to predict. So this is, again, my type 1, type 2 errors. So I think all of these are important facts. And also, together with this additional piece of information here, that if we look at risk premium after financial crisis, this is where risk premium tends to be really high. And this is different after wars. So there's this striking evidence put together by Muir, which shows that, you know, you have a really big decline in consumption after wars, and yet the big risk premium tend to be after financial crisis. So pointing to the importance of modeling the process of financial intermediation, I think, also in that whole story. Now, another piece of element which I want to emphasize is, again, this global dimension of these booms and busts. We see a lot of co-movements. So I talked in 2013 of a global financial cycle, that is to say fluctuations in financial activity measured by risk-taking as in leverage of gross capital flows, asset prices, spread, etc., which operate on a global scale. And there's a lot of co-movements in these variables. A lot of co-movements, especially across the main currency areas, lots of common factor seemingly explaining the variance in a lot of these variables. Now, then, obviously, one next step in trying to understand, still in a kind of relatively reduced form way, what is happening, and before talking more about the theory, is to have some more empirical evidence of what are the drivers of these global factors, this global financial cycle. And there, one piece of evidence that we have is that US monetary policy is one of these drivers. Not the only one, obviously, but it's one of the drivers of this global, let's say, risk on, risk off phenomenon, whichever way you want to call it, or global global risk appetite. I think we are seeing both now in macro data and also in credit registry data, so in very disaggregated microeconomic data at the banking level, that there is this importance of US monetary policy transmitting itself cross-border. So just to show you two graphs taken from a paper in which there is a Bayesian VAR with 25 variables, and monetary policy shocks are identified via an instrument, so a proxy VAR. This is the impact of a US monetary policy tightening, 100 basis point increase in the effective funds rate on US domestic credit, goes down, as expected. But what is probably less expected is that the global domestic credit, excluding US, is also very economically and significantly affected. And you see that in many variables. You see it in cross-border credit as well. You also see the effect of US tightening not only on US broker-dealers, which you would expect in terms of their leverage going down once there is a tightening, but also on the euro area, systematically important banks' leverage, and also the UK, globally systematically important banks' leverage, in ways that are quite similar. And I think we now have a kind of body of evidence that tends to show that for some financial markets, the effect of US monetary policy is in the same ballpark if you look within border and if you look cross-border in other financial markets. Now, this idea about global financial cycle, which can be related to what also Alan presented just in the session before, and Atif, and what Carmen presented, also help us. We have this boom and bust pattern that Carmen talked about, to rationalize the episode of low real rates in which we are currently seeing. So on this, I've done some work with Pierre-Olivier using a Campbell-Shiller decomposition and extracting some information on the joint dynamics of consumption wealth ratio and safe rates, risk premia, and dividend and consumption growth. And there we can show that essentially there are two episodes, and these are two of these global boom-bust episodes that Carmen was talking about, in which there's a lot of similarities. These are the 1920s with this irrational exuberance in asset markets, followed by the Great Depression and then deleveraging and low real rates, and the financial crisis of the 1990s-2000s with, again, irrational exuberance in asset markets, crisis, and then, again, deleveraging. Okay, so this is the kind of what we learned from facts, from all this data, which I think extraordinarily useful. And then we have to ask ourselves, let's revisit a little bit our theory of crisis. And so here we have Ricardo's input, where he puts the risk-centric global macroeconomics here, environment, with in a particular focus on the supply of safe assets and emphasizing the fact that emerging markets have trouble to actually produce safe assets and that they are growing more than the rest of the world. So we have two things going on, I think. In all your model, Ricardo, on the one hand, we have this trend change, so which is, you know, with which you can explain things such as the direction of capital flows and capital imbalances via this supply of this shortage of safe assets, which becomes more acute as emerging markets are more important in the world. And you also have a whole bunch of papers where there is also the cyclical dimension to that. There is a shock. And there's an uncertainty shock, and people, and there's suddenly an exacerbation of this shortage of safe assets, and there there's flight to safety and a number of things, safety trap and real effect on the economy that can unfold. So there's the cyclical aspect and the trend aspect, I think, of this safe asset shortage, which is very interesting in your work, and which has quite a bit of explanatory power across different phenomena. So, very briefly, I think one thing that I found useful in trying to think about the type of world that Ricardo has used to explain a lot of very different and interesting phenomena is that, in a way, it's a Minsky-type world. So, when a recession happens, it's because there's this flight to quality, people trying to shift their portfolios into safe assets, and eliminating the excess demand for safe assets in a world, new world that could be via the expansion of actually some type of guarantees to expand that supply of safe assets, will bring the goods and labor markets out of excess supplies and back into balance. So that's one way of interpreting the type of world across your models. There's it's slightly different, but could be related to a more like Keynesian world where actually the excess demand is for bonds to transfer purchasing power from the present into the future. And there's a problem of the natural rate of interest maybe being too low in some situation and we being at the zero lower bound. And then the policy there would be expansionary monetary policy to reduce the market rate, or if not possible, acting on the natural rate of interest via fiscal policy. So that would be another thing. And again, we have this this shortage, this time of bond, which can be maybe dealt with policy and in order to get back the goods and labor markets back in balance. And that would be more some types of models along the lines of Gauthier and Paul and Veronica and Guido. And then we could also think of a more maybe Friedmanian type world where actually the excess, the shortage is for money as a medium of exchange. And there, what the central bank would want to do is to boost the money stock. And again, we could that would be a way of dealing with this shortage. So I think all these things have some point of connection with some older disequilibrium literature theory. I was inspired in that by some remarks by Brad DeLong. Okay, so if we think about, I do think it would be interesting actually to think more about the connection between this type of disequilibrium and this type of worlds. Now, if we think of the existing literature in on our modeling of crisis and microfinance, so there's a lot of papers have to do with pecuniary externalities, which we talked about a lot today. And these models explain very well the bust phase of the cycle, the amplification phase. But I think what we still need to work on from a theoretical point of view are precisely this risk build-up phase, which could be thought as an over-investment phase of a cycle in models with some the right type of friction, of how we think about these credit supply driving what is happening, monetary policy or elsewhere, and also how we think about empirically the large heterogeneity in credit creation behavior over time and across financial intermediaries, okay, which is also a very important stylized fact in the data. And what we see in the data is that there are risk concentration, and in particular macroeconomic risk concentration, in certain balance sheets at different points of the cycle. And I think this type of risk concentration is very important to understand financial vulnerability. So this type of facts, I think, are very important to inform further the modeling that we do of this crisis, as well as the capacity of model to get the asset pricing right, in the sense of so models such as the one we write tend to have to struggle to match this pre-crisis data of low spread simply because they tend to reflect, they are forward-looking, the increased risk of a crisis, the increased fragility in our models, and therefore they will tend to have a too high a risk premium. So that's also a major challenge. So I have very little time, so I will just mention that I think there are various leads maybe to add certain features to our model of crisis in order to match better the data that Carmen presented or Alan or Ken presented. So one avenue is to have introduced more or different types of friction, more risk shifting for the build-up phase or some type of bounded rationality. For the asset pricing, the heterogeneity, it was mentioned, is quite important and buys us a lot. If you have either optimistic or pessimist, or if you have different ability to take risk, then you're going to have the right cyclical property also of risk-taking via a shifting composition of investors' pool. So that's very important. And heterogeneity will also give you this time variation in concentration of risk, which is very important to understand systemic risk and financial vulnerability, in my views. All right, so I'm just going to conclude by saying, well, so that's a great research agenda in front of us. I think we made a lot of progress, but the boom phase in the theory, the heterogeneity of investors, in particular of intermediaries, given the key role in asset pricing, and interaction between monetary policy and financial stabilities are really, I think, a booming area of research and for the right reasons.
Thank you.